Shin. I come from Kenya, and I'd like to do a short presentation on the topic of youth in agriculture. Yesterday I was last, and you know the Bible says the last shall be the first, and it has surely happened to me. So, why do I want to talk about youth in agriculture? The aim of this talk is to stimulate increased participation of youth in agriculture. And as we go along, you'll see why it's a cause for concern. The objectives of this talk are to raise awareness of county officials on the current situation, that is an aging population in agriculture. The other thing we want to do is to step up agricultural instruction in schools, which is something that has really gone down in the current times. And again, something else that I'd really like to see happen is youth-friendly fora being designed so that youth have a chance to interact with entrepreneurs that can help them understand why it's important for them to take agriculture as a way of life and as a source of livelihood. In introduction, I'd just like to remind us that our world relies on agriculture really for life, so to speak. Agriculture gives us food, it provides clothing for us, and it also keeps our environment healthy, because the interactions between how we use our environment and how nature wants it to be have to come to a place where they run in sync. And I remember that one of the icons in my country, the late Professor Wangari Maathai, said that nature is very unforgiving. If you do not do your things in tandem with nature, you're going to pay for it someday. The current situation, according to the United Nations Development Program in an agricultural journal that they wrote, in Kenya, the average age of farmers is 60. And as I looked at it in other parts of the world, there are places where it even goes as far as 70 and 75 years of age. And as I looked at that, I thought it was a really scary fact, because if that is the case, and again, back to the Bible, I remember we're told that the days of man on earth are 70 and 10, that is 70 in short. It's 70 in English. If that is true, that means that we don't even have 20 years really to bring our youth on board. We have a much shorter time, because if the aging population is at 60 years and the gap that we're talking about is 20, there is something that we need to think about. There's a mismatch that needs to be sorted out, and quickly. This picture shows us the average farmer across the world from the various continents. You can see that it's something that runs across the whole world. And so let's look at other issues. Bringing the youth on board. To make sure that we do not kill agriculture and in the process kill ourselves, because remember we said it is food, it is clothing, it is our environment. We need to do something to bring the youth on board. And if we train the youth now, they'll be ready to take over when we are all crawling on our knees with age. And many young people don't want to get into agriculture. Why? Because they think it's dirty. One wise man, Mr. William Washer, says the best way to bring the youth into agriculture or to make it attractive for them is to make it into a profitable business. And like I was sharing with my colleagues yesterday, youth want money in their pocket yesterday. They're in a hurry to get their pockets filled out. And as we know, agriculture will not give you the quick buck. But whatever you get out of agriculture, if you do it sustainably, it is something that you can count on tomorrow and the day after. Unlike the Bitcoin, which I hear the British want to take off the internet. How do we do this? One of the things that we need to do is to mentor the young people. And if we allow the young people to work alongside us, maybe not in such drudgery, but one way or another, bring the young people alongside us as we do our agricultural activities. We'll be able to pass on basic skills to them. We'll be able to impart the nobleness of agriculture into their lives. The second thing we need to do, especially in my country, is to reintroduce agriculture in the school curriculum. Just before agriculture was taken off school curriculums, many times when a pupil did something that was gross, they were punished by being given a farming implement and sent onto the school farm to do some manual labor as a punishment. And those are some of the things that have dented the image of agriculture. We find that when children learn skills in school, they're in a hurry to pass them on because the teacher is always right. So if we can bring agriculture into school, our children will be very willing to come home and tell us, teacher said this, and that would be a starting point for them getting into the mainstream of agriculture. The other thing that we could do for those that are beyond school age is see how to revolutionize farming. Look at technology that maximizes production. Look at technology that is interesting to use, and out of that interest will come production that can become useful for mankind. Some of the technological things that we're talking about is greenhouse farming, which you'll find young people gravitating towards because it will be more like, you know, more up their alley really than breaking their backs with a handhold. The other thing that we need to do is support young people with technical information and startup capital. As we have been moving around the UK visiting farmers, one of the things that we've heard again and again spoken about, both by the older people and the young, is that it is very difficult for young people to break into agriculture because of the massive investment that you need to put into it, the kind of money that young people may not have to start up. So if we can find ways of supporting young people to get into the industry and do some of the things that we have shown there, maybe like money to start someone off, a kind of a loan to start someone off digging a fish pond and stocking it, like the one on your right, I think. Sometimes I mix up my hands. And the other young man in production of poultry, those are two of the very quick return forms of agricultural production that we have seen in Kenya. If we can support the young people and get them jump-started, it would be a good thing for them to be able to mainstream it. The other thing in my country is the use of mobile phones. My sentence says, step up the use of mobile phones in agribusiness. That means that it is already ongoing, but it needs to be expanded because it's a good thing. And the use of mobile phone platforms passes a lot of information to common interest groups. For example, you get an overview of market prices of commodities across the country just by looking at your phone. You can also get information on where to get certain inputs just by looking at your phone on the right platforms. It is also a place where people with technological information can put information for quick access for those that need it on the spot. Then, this is a picture that was taken at Bedford Young Farmers Rally. Just looking at those little boys and girls handling the livestock, interacting with what it means to be in the farming business. And maybe it's not so obvious from the picture, but there were entrepreneurs in that forum, people who are displaying machinery, talking about technology. So these young people have a chance to start interacting with those people from a very tender age, and it begins to grow on them. So this is another thing that I believe is a really good thing that we could do. And in conclusion, I talked about funding. Funds are a bit of an issue that causes skittishness in people's thinking. But there are places where the youth can get some startup capital or a hand up as they start in my country. It is just that they need to be pushed in that direction. Some of them are the Youth Enterprise Fund, which is available for young people within the age bracket of what's called youth, up to the age of 35 and coming downwards, young adults. We have the Women Enterprise Fund, which targets specifically the female population. So the ladies have a double-barreled gun. They can get money from the Youth Enterprise Fund, they can also get money from the Women Enterprise Fund. Then we have table banking groups, and this is a way that people within a community are able to mobilize funds from among themselves and loan each other and return with interest and build a base, a capital base for whatever they want to do. At the end of the year, what they do is a share out. So all the profit that they've earned from their borrowing and lending is shared out among the members of that group in proportion to how much one has saved, because you save it in form of shares, and then when share out is done, money is shared out according to how much you've saved. Mobile phone technology, again, I think I've spoken about that. Then government employed technical officers, they are available, they may be very few. The farmer staff ratio is very poor, because you'll find one staff member like serving around 6,000-7,000 farmers, which is a massive number, they will not be able to reach them. But those that really have need are able to access technical advice from officers to a certain extent. And I say that all of the young people really need is a push in the right direction and a hand up to pick them up and get them moving. And I believe it's something that we are capable of doing. I'd just like to say thank you. And before you think I'm very clever, I had a lot of help from those conferences. So I'll be happy to take questions if I answer that.